don't think your phone is actually silent, Ken. I think you're making that up.
I tried to make it silent. Well, it's a new phone. I don't know what I'm doing.
I'm pretty sure. It's not as silent as you think it is.
It's not.
It's not as silent as you think. All right. Hey.
You know who was silent today?
The Cleveland Browns.
There you go.
They were plenty silent today. And
that's a radio transition right there.
Certainly. That's not bad. Not bad, bud. Welcome in. It is the Project Game Day post-game show. We'll tell you what the final score is when it's final. There's 8 minutes left, but it's 38-6. Glenn Clark, Ken Zales with you. It's all brought to you by Wise Markets and the U.S. Army. Happy to have you on board. We want to chat with you about a Ravens blowout win that was as expected. Maybe you thought the game might be a little bit closer because it's the NFL, but particularly in this year where there is no continuity in Cleveland and no preseason, I never thought that this game was going to be close whatsoever. Do appreciate the Ravens giving us something to complain about in the second half, as it's insane that they would have Lamar Jackson dropping back to throw with 8 minutes left in a 38-6 game and no left tackle on the field.
Yeah.
Nuts that they would be doing something like that.
Well, that he's even in the game at that point.
Well, I would agree with you, he shouldn't be in the game. But certainly, if you're going to have him in the game, for whatever
hand
reason
off.
You feel like, you just and who cares? Pat Ricard gets a 15-yard penalty. You know what you do? You hand the ball off anyway because the game's over. You don't need to be throwing the ball when you're leading 38-6 in the fourth quarter of a game against the Browns. Not necessary, just a dumb thing for you to be doing. And I'm sure John Harbaugh will be asked about it post-game, and I'm sure he'll say something about reps and the fact they didn't have preseason games and wanting those guys out there and treating it like a live practice and all that. I have no doubt that all of those things will be said and that there's an amount of truth to all of them, but none of them outweigh whatever risk there might be of having your quarterback dropping back to pass or running the ball, for that matter. Like, you shouldn't have him do anything. He should be handing the ball off and removing himself from the play every time. There is nothing to be gained, and whatever risk there might be is greater than whatever there is to be gained. So there's that.
Yes.
Appreciate them doing that,
yes.
Because otherwise we would have literally nothing to complain about. Ken, there's two things that jump out at me. One being the obvious story at the moment is what's going on with Ronnie Stanley. Is that significant? It clearly wasn't going to matter today, but undoubtedly it would matter. Ronnie Stanley is one of the best football players on this team. He's one of the best left tackles in football. While DJ Fluker is a veteran, and it was interesting, we were all assuming that Fluker was going to be the guy at right guard. They went with Tyree Phillips, and he seemed to hold up pretty well throughout the course of the game.
Yeah.
DJ Fluker is not the guy that you want to have being your left tackle. So that will be the first sort of big story that we'll be paying attention to as the week goes along, is the impact of the Ronnie Stanley injury and whether or not that extends for a little bit. As I don't know if you've heard, there's a pretty significant football game that's looming here in a couple of weeks that they would probably like to have Ronnie Stanley back for, because they're likely going to need to score a lot of points in order to win that game.
I'd like him back for next week against J.J. Watt.
Sure. Yeah. I would like to have him back right now, for what it's worth. I'm not trying to be completely dismissive of the Texans. I like the Ravens' chances almost whether or not they have him out there next week. I'm far more concerned about what happens 2 weeks from tomorrow night when the Kansas City Chiefs come to town. So there's that, but there's nothing to debate about that.
Right.
We just have to wait for information. The conversation, and I addressed this at halftime, and I've been addressing it all throughout the course of the week, that I've been asking everybody is, again, everything about this season will be gauged by what happens in the postseason.
Correct.
We're almost doing a dance where nothing matters. Like, really, the Chiefs game is about the only game, unless something goes, you know, terribly, you know, south during the course of the year, the only game that's really going to matter is going to be the Chiefs game. And outside of that, everything the Ravens do, largely our reaction is going to be, okay, cool, right? Unless, they do something disastrous. And by the way, they're going to end up losing a game you don't expect them to lose because this is the NFL.
They always do.
Yes.
Like the Browns last year.
Exactly right. They're going to end up having one of those occur. Or the playoff game last year, unfortunately.
I didn't want to bring up that.
That being said, they're going to play all 16 of these games anyway. Or 15 more after today, and every time they play, I'm trying to figure out what we can learn from those games that might give us a better sense of how prepared they are to do this in the postseason. That's the prism by which I'm trying to look through everything. And today, I said at halftime, that last drive before the half...
So impressive.
I can't dismiss it. To me, it's a huge story. It's a huge story in how we look at this game. I get it. The Browns stink. The Ravens blew them out. Blah, 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 blah. But in trying to take things and pick them out of the game and say, here's what might matter, that drive before the half is what might matter to me, because that goes back to this question about what happens when the Ravens can't just do things the way that they want to do them, when they're forced to do things another way. Well, because of the clock in that situation, you're forced to do things another way. You're not just going to go out there and run the football on a possession like that. You're forced to do something else. So that day, in that moment, something about that, I file away for what happens come postseason. That this is a team that is showing signs that they might be comfortable. While, yes, today, largely, they were able to play bully ball and do things the way they wanted to do them. In that moment, when they couldn't, they still handled themselves not only quite nicely, they handled themselves to the tune of marching down the field in less than 50 seconds and scoring a touchdown.
Yeah, I mean, you have to look at that. I agree with you. I mean, it's a funny thing that here we are week one, and I wasn't as confident as you that they would blow out the Browns. You know, the first week of the NFL I thought would be sloppy in many situations, including the Ravens, which they were not. They were very sharp early and you know, got a little sloppier in the second half as far as the penalties go. But, you know, things you can learn. Lamar Jackson looks absolutely fantastic.
But I expected him to.
No, but there's another step to it. Like last year, from his rookie year to last year, he took a step.
100%.
He's not relying so much. I mean, very few RPOs today.
Fewer, no question about
pocket,
that.
Pocket passer, in command, check downs, the whole nine yards, deep throw, right on target. You can see that he's worked, and it's the next progression, not just we were told about it and that he looked great in camp and things like that. I want to continue to see that. I wanted to see how the offense emerged to a more using the wide receivers more with Hurst being gone and not having so much of the three tight end set. I thought there were wide receivers open all day long, all over the field.
Now, to be fair, the Browns secondary Stinson was wildly depleted today too by injury.
I understand
yes.
that. But to me, in looking at, you know, we look at combinations and who was on the field and how were they going to, not knowing that they don't have that second pass-catching tight end, how were they going to deploy different people? We saw Duvernay.
Duvernay.
Very early today. We saw Boykin make a couple of plays. I mean, there were things that even though who the opponent was and they were depleted, I liked the personnel that was on the field and giving them options. So that to me was, how was it going to look? Because it was going to look different from last year.
I learned a little bit. I'm not as inclined to read a lot from that in week one, in particular because of who the opponent was, in particular because of the circumstances, right? But that's fine. I hear you. And I think my expectations were they were going to look like a well-oiled machine today because they did not need the offseason the way that other teams needed the offseason. They absolutely were a team that could pick up and be the same type of team that they were a year ago, whereas their opponent had a completely new system, a completely new philosophy, all of those things, and were not particularly good to begin with. So that was my expectation for the day. Did they surpass that? Arguably they surpassed that. Look, I think everybody is excited about J.K. Dobbins, but we were all excited about J.K. Dobbins coming in, right? Like, I'm not walking away today and saying, oh, man, they really found something in J.K. Dobbins. My expectation was the J.K. Dobbins show was going to start very soon. I've always thought it was going to be far sooner than later that J.K. Dobbins was going to be this team's featured back and the offense was going to be built around him. In fact, I think we're merely scratching the surface when it comes to J.K. Dobbins. I still believe that there might be more of a role that involves him catching some passes and doing some more things that he didn't necessarily get to do at Ohio State. But yet we're already very impressed. Patrick Queen looked very good.
Good.
Harrison looked very good.
Queen struggled a bit to start the game. He looked a little bit shaky. Everybody looked shaky on the stretch runs. And again, that's if we're looking to nitpick.
Yeah.
They looked poor against the stretch run in the first half. And the game circumstances, in part, the Browns got away from it because they chose to get away from it. And then the game circumstances forced them away from it. It forced them from being able to go back and try to use that. If it had been a closer, more competitive game, you would have concerns about what might have played out over four quarters.
I think you still have concerns because they gave up over 5 yards, 5.5 yards a carry.
100%.
Today. Now, granted, they gave it up against two really good running backs. I mean, Chubb is a really good player.
And they have a better offensive line than I think people give them credit for.
They do. They made improvements there, and that's fine. But, I mean, that's still, you know, I saw a couple of, and it really wasn't for me, which is surprising, like smart little comments on Twitter. That was like, oh, I'm glad they went out and fixed the run game.
When you spend your entire offseason prioritizing stopping the run, and then you struggle against the run, people are going to notice that.
Correct. But I think overall, you know, I like the Queen-Harrison combination. I think they covered the middle field. I know the tight ends got a couple of things, but also the Browns came out with a bunch of three tight end sets, which was a little surprising from my standpoint. I didn't expect that, especially the rookie Bryant.
They've got the personnel.
They do, but I was still surprised the rookie Bryant was on the field so early. But, you know, they it seemed like the middle of the field, they kind of cleared up a little bit. You got Harrison on the one interception, what should have been an interception, got deep enough to make a tip on a ball, which was fantastic. Mm-hmm. Calais Campbell, you know, as advertised early, as far as being a disruptor up front.
Tyus Bowser definitely looked good today.
Bowser looked fantastic. Even Ferguson got a couple of pressures today. So it's, you know, I always remind people, pass rush isn't about getting a sack all the time. It's about getting a pressure.
Sure.
And I thought they, you know, again, it's a, like you said, it's a little bit easier when you know that the other team has to throw every down. You just pin your ears.
Of course.
Pin your ears back.
You get
and
after
go.
It, right.
So take that into account. But I thought that they – you liked what you saw out of new people. And that's ultimately once this game – and to me, at 10-0, when the Browns went for the fake punt – I was talking to a buddy of mine. I was like, this game's over. I was like, this is just the same.
Well, that was
Browns.
Insane. I mean, like, it was absolutely insane. And again, I don't care because I'm not in Cleveland. Why would I ever care?
I don't care either.
But what's insane is that you would go for a fake punt there, but then late in the first half, when you're faced with fourth and two on the other side of the field, and knowing how capable the Ravens are of moving the football right now, you would say, oh, but we'll settle for a field goal attempt here instead of maybe trying to convert that. At worst case, kick a field goal where there's less time on the clock for the Ravens to do something with it, and best case scenario, give yourselves a chance to score a touchdown and make it a competitive game, perhaps going into the second half. Clearly, we don't care. Screw up every decision you want to screw up.
Be 0-16, I don't care.
No, what you're doing, like what the thought process is, they're going for this insane fake punt early on and then being faced with a fourth and two on the other side of the field and saying to yourself, oh, gee, that's just a bridge too far. We just can't do something like that. Those are the types of things we used to complain about a lot around these parts of the world, and thankful that we don't do quite as much of that anymore. From Scott, he thinks that leaving Lamar Jackson in the game is showing that they're not willing to take their foot off the pedal.
Whatever.
It's insane.
Okay.
I mean, it's just insane.
Okay. It's 38-6.
Like,
get them out of the game.
I don't know what you think of that.
What foot do you want on the whatever? That would be a typical Harbaugh statement at the end that would just drive me insane.
It'd be like talking about trying to win a preseason game.
It doesn't
mean anything.
Yeah,
like,
you
I don't know what you think that means.
Don't take your foot off the pedal, and then all of a sudden somebody late in the game, some third stringer that's in for the Browns defense, lights them up for no reason in a late hit, and yeah, you're going to be celebrating that, oh, I love the attitude of the team because they don't take the foot off the pedal. Get out of here.
No, but by the way, I do think there's a relevant argument for that when it's a 28-7 game in the third quarter and you're saying, hey, look, this is still a football game.
Right.
This isn't over.
Right.
We can't
fourth
just
quarter, 10 minutes left
we
to go.
We can't just turtle up with 13 minutes to play in the third quarter because we feel comfortable and we want to run the clock out. Like, we still have work to do. We still have to go do something at that point in the football game. It's a completely different circumstance than you get to the fourth quarter, you're winning going away, and you're still choosing to drop your quarterback back behind a reserve left tackle, behind someone that was completely available for anybody to play at any position, and nobody thinks is a left tackle in the NFL at the moment. Yeah. That's just reckless. That's not aggressive. It's purely reckless for absolutely no gain. There's just nothing to be gained there. There's nothing to be said about the foot and the pedal or whatever you think that is. Your guy, AJ, best offense, best defense, best special teams, dumbest coach, but who cares? I mean, imagine criticizing the coach.
I'm not criticizing
after they win 38-6.
I'm not criticizing today. Look, there are always things in games that I don't like, but it's like, you know, did I love, you know, you're driving down the field. Did I love the Patrick Ricard thing where he fumbled? No. You have three bulldozer running backs.
It's really weird. I got to be honest with you. I don't understand this complaint, right? Is the idea that Patrick Ricard can never have a handoff?
No, I said you can complain about that.
But I don't know. I just don't understand what the complaint is.
That you have Lamar, you have Ingram, you have J.K. Dobbs, you have Gus Edwards, all guys that can do it, and you have a fullback who can blow up the hole. Just have somebody run behind the fullback and let him do what he normally does.
But is the argument that Pat Ricard can never get a handoff?
Pat Ricard should never get a handoff for me.
I mean, that's a weird bit, man.
Okay.
It's a really weird bit.
I'm not complaining about it. I'm saying we saw people when it happened complain about it. I was like, you know, and it's like even I, you know, look, it's my stance is my stance. Whatever it is on Harbaugh. I'm not complaining. They won 38-6. I even told somebody on Twitter to shut up. Because he was complaining over everything. I was like, can you just relax?
Well, sure. I mean, there are always going to be people like that. But what I would say a step further is I think that there's things to complain about. Like, we're talking about the decision to drop back Lamar Jackson in the fourth quarter because it's fair.
It's fair to talk
about that. The Pat Ricard thing, I just don't think. I think we're frustrated by the results, so we're blaming the process. Well, sometimes, you blame the player.
Yes.
Like, Pat Ricard's got to hold on to the football.
Got to hold on to the ball.
He's a fullback / tight end. He needs to be able to hold on to the football in those circumstances. And I like Pat Ricard and think he does wonderful things. But his role in the offense requires him to be able to get the football and hold on to it. He didn't hold on to it.
That's
on him.
From the other side of the coin, there are seven other ways you can get the ball in from the 2-yard line that don't include a guy that, yes, he should have to hold on to the ball, but is not one of the primary guys that you rely to hold on to the ball. I can understand that point. To sit there and complain about it when you're up 17-0 or whatever it is at that point, 10-0, and you're playing dominant football is a little much for me, even me. So, but
well, I disagree and I hate you, just for the record. I disagree and
I personally hate you, and I
think you're a wretched human being.
I'm on my way to eating a bunch of sandwiches based on my picks today, so you should love me.
Oh, I do like that. Yeah,
I think everything I said this week is just, as far as games go, is wrong.
Why does John Little Rock hate Frank Reich? What's the story on...
I have no idea.
Is it because the Colts end up losing the Jaguars?
I'm sure.
Did you have the Jaguar or the Colts in your survivor pool? Because
I did.
It's not a good way to go down.
I'm out. I'm done.
I understand the Jaguars hate. I just didn't really understand why anybody had much of expectations for a Colts team.
I had zero expectation for the Jaguars. That was my.
Well, I get that
thing.
Part. I completely understand that.
I just thought the Jaguars were going to be totally outclassed, and I thought Indianapolis with a really good offensive line and two really good running backs, which, you know, again, you try to get cute sometimes and it backfires on you. And, you know, Phillip Rivers, you know, when at the end of the day, he threw two interceptions, cost them the game.
I would have preferred they just, if I cared about the Colts, which I clearly do not, but if I did, I would have preferred they go and get a quarterback instead of doing a Phillip Rivers experiment.
I would have played Brissett, and if you didn't want to go draft somebody or something like that, by the way, the team, is going to beat the Philadelphia Eagles. They're going to come back.
That's unbelievable.
They're
going to
come back from 17 points down.
That's going to be a
and
survivor.
Blow them out.
There's going to be a lot of survivor problems.
A lot of survivor pulls that are going to have a problem with that.
Thankfully, if you took the Ravens in your survivor pool, which would have been a good pick.
Would have been an easy pick. It's not how you win survivor pools, but week one, sometimes you just got to play it a little
sometimes,
safe.
Right.
Just got to play it safe.
Take the one, go on from there.
I preached to everybody. I was like, just play it safe this week. Go with guys that we think we know what their role
is. Yeah, played it safe with Mark Ingram. Thanks a lot for that. Jesus.
He just didn't get the touchdown.
No, he did not. He didn't really do anything, frankly, today.
He got the most touches from the backfield.
Great. That's
10.
Wonderful. Do they start giving out points for that?
In some leagues, they do for carries.
That's a really weird bit. Yeah. That is a really, really weird bit. All right, from Tony. Tony says, guys, everything to be happy about after this first game. I think sometimes we forget this is the NFL and that goofy things happen. Just look around the league today. We were referring to some of that just a minute ago. Every reason to be happy as a Ravens fan right now and do feel confident going to what should be two tough games. I mean, I guess the Houston game we're supposed to still say is a tough game, and I don't want to dismiss them because they got their asses kicked by the Chiefs. A lot of teams get their asses kicked by the Chiefs. I am certainly not fearful of the Houston Texans the way that I have been in other years where the Houston Texans, frankly, had better players on their roster.
Totally agree with that.
This is a Houston Texans team that has lost, you know, two of their top four players over the course of the last year. They have not replaced it with much that makes you fearful of them. They do still have a very good quarterback. There is no question about that. I don't think they're the team to beat in their division this season. I don't know why anybody would have thought that going into the year after seeing what happened a year ago.
No.
So, to say I'm fearful of them, it's a road game. Although, what does that mean in 2020? I don't know. I have no idea what it means. I just don't really fear. I'm trying to figure out what the line will be for that game. I'm guessing, despite it being on the road, the Ravens will be favored by somewhere in the neighborhood of 3.5-4 points, is my guess.
I think after the two games, I think they'll be...
You think it'll be more closer to a touchdown?
I think they'll be 5, because you get the 3 for being at home. It would be an 8-point spread.
Right.
You get the 3.
See, I was thinking it was
going
to be like a touch. It would be like a touchdown game on a neutral field, and then the 3 points would bump it back closer
I think people are going to try to... I think the way Vegas does these things...
They expect the overreaction and try to react to that. I could see that. The first game that any of us are going to have a significant reaction to, unless somehow the Ravens throw up all over themselves next week, will be the Kansas City game. It's the first time that what they do, if they win that game, it will matter. Otherwise, everything they do kind of only matters if it goes the other way, right? Like, for the most part this season, it will only matter. They could go 16-0 during the course. Take that back. They go 15-1, only lose to the Chiefs.
Yes.
And at the end of the year, we'd sort of walk back like, okay, they did what they were supposed to do.
14-2 last year.
That's going to be our reaction. But
after the last two seasons, Glenn, it's fair.
And I'm not saying it isn't fair.
I mean,
it's the reality of the circumstances, which, by the way, let's all talk about the fact that it's amazing circumstances to be in.
It is.
Like, I'd kill to be in these circumstances in a lot of our
history. We were spoiled
for
so long that we were in these circumstances.
Correct.
And we had a couple of bumpy, three bumpy years where we weren't. And luckily, you have a transcendent player right now. And you're going to be in this situation.
But in a weird way, even in the previous years, it was more like...
Well, last year you didn't expect 14-2.
What I'm saying is, like, you're going back to the previous era. And in that previous era, it was almost the opposite of this, where, like, it kind of didn't matter what happened in the regular season as long as you got in. Because you had such faith that once they got in, they were going to be capable of doing special things. Now we're doing the exact opposite thing. We're saying, like, all of the wins don't matter in the regular season.
I mean,
like,
I know.
In a weird world, you'd rather go 10-6 a decade ago, because a decade ago at 10-6, you felt pretty damn good about your chances.
Well, this was the argument. You know my bid over years. That every year, I pick the Ravens to go 10-6, no matter what they've done the year before. They're going to go 10-6,
right?
Because and people were like, you're just saying that. I was like, doing the same thing. It doesn't matter. They could go 10-6, win the division again, because I thought the Browns would be a little bit better. Mm-hmm. I think the Steelers are going to be a little bit better, whatever. But if they don't get to at least the AFC Championship, it doesn't matter. It just doesn't.
And it's all this season is about.
And
I talked about this a year ago. There are smaller non-Super Bowl things that can be demarcations, right? Once upon a time, the Ravens needed to prove they could win a playoff game in Pittsburgh. They needed to do that. They could not have that still hanging over them at all times. So even in that season, when they didn't end up getting the AFC Championship game, it was still very valuable that they had proven that they could go win a playoff game in Pittsburgh. This year, there's, to me, right now, two lines of demarcation for this team. One, of course, is what you're referring to. Mm-hmm. Deep run in the postseason. Yes. Not even really just winning
winning a playoff game. It's got to be.
If they just win their first playoff game this year, but then lose in the AFC Championship game, we're going to have problems again. Like, they've got to win.
I guess
it's Kansas City.
If you get to the AFC Championship game and you happen to lose to Kansas City,
Kansas City. Right. But that goes back to the other line.
If you lose to Tennessee again in the AFC Championship,
it's
going to
be a problem, no doubt.
It's going to be a problem.
The other line of demarcation is Kansas City. That's it. Like, there's two things that you're measuring this team by. One, do they win the Super Bowl? Two, can they finally get over the Kansas City hump? Which, again, 2 years ago, they were very close. A year ago, we were pretending like they were close because the final score made it look like it was close. They got their asses handed to them by Kansas City a year ago.
Yeah.
Now, it was early on in the season and before they were really gelling, but we're pretending like they played two close games against Kansas City, which is a fallacy. They got their asses kicked a year ago by the Chiefs. So that's the next line of demarcation they can meet, is what happens in 2 weeks when they play the Chiefs. And if they win that game, it will matter. It will matter because that won't be hanging over them anymore. But if they lose that game, we're going to talk for the rest of the season, no matter what they do. We're going to keep coming back on here and having the same conversation.
Discussion.
We're going to keep saying, but they got to figure out how to beat the Chiefs. Yeah, how do they get past the Chiefs? Yeah, okay, but they're still the Chiefs. And they could literally go 15-1.
Yep.
Win every other game.
Yep.
And we would still sit here and say, but what are they going to do when it's the Chiefs?
Mm-hmm.
What are they going to do when they have to beat them? That's the reality of the circumstances that we're in. We should be celebrating more. I understand that it should be a pleasant day.
Well, no, this is you have to set a tone for the season, and this is the tone.
It's reality.
And we didn't set this. Their performance in the playoffs of the last 2 years set this.
Correct.
You know, I know you were on the road 2 years ago, but you went 7-1. Getting to that road playoff game, you were dead in the water until Lamar took over, and then you ran through everything with this new offense,
mm-hmm.
and then you went and laid an egg entirely in the playoffs. Last year, 14-2, picking right where you left off in the regular season, out of nowhere, just dominant. I mean, not 14-2 like, you know, miracle finishes. 14-2 and the games were over in the third quarter.
Yep.
And you laid an egg.
Yeah, man. It's tough because you want to be able to celebrate.
You
want to be able to enjoy.
I love this.
No,
this was great because
it's
the Browns.
It's so much better than what we've dealt with, where you had to sweat out games against bad football teams and sometimes lose games to bad football teams. I far prefer it, but yet.
Yeah, it is what it is.
We are still sitting here saying to ourselves, okay, but it's just the Browns and this doesn't really matter all that much.
And you're so right. In 2 weeks, if they lay an egg, and even if they beat the Kansas City Chiefs,
I think it will matter.
I think it will significantly matter if they beat the Chiefs. It matters. Until they get to the playoffs.
Well, I'm not saying that conversation
it's
will still
matter.
Be there.
It's going to matter.
But in the context of what we can learn during the regular season, that will matter.
Even if they play a close game against the Chiefs,
if they lose, no, even if it's a thriller like it was the first time, if they lose, it still hangs, it still looms, still you have to get over the hump. Pat Mahomes is not dead until he's dead. It took a miracle for the Chiefs to win the first one, but Pat Mahomes makes miracles because that's who he is. That's the nature of having that guy as your quarterback. So we'll still be thinking about it for sure. All right, I need 1 minute. We'll come back in, get some more of your responses, and start setting things up for week two. Ken Zales is here. I'm Glenn Clark. This is PressBox's Project Game Day postgame show brought to you by Wise Markets and the U.S. Army.
Glory Days Grill's Oktoberfest menu is available now. Our fall seasonal menu is available for dine-in, dine-out, on the patio, or to-go. It's a new season, so enjoy new flavors. Try their new chicken schnitzel or the delicious Prussian pretzel rolls. Glory Days is open from 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. every day. Visit GloryDaysGrill.com for a location near you. From the Glory Days Grill family, stay healthy and positive during this challenging time in our community.
Looking to get one up on the competition? Supercharge your computer skills. CCBC has classes at all levels from beginner to expert coder. Explore Microsoft Office, gaming, or even ethical hacker. Maybe hardware is your gig. Become A-plus certified. All tuition free if you qualify. Call 443-840-4700 or visit ccbcmd.edu/quickreg.
With Wise Market's lowest price guarantee, we guarantee the lowest price in the area. If a local competitor advertises any of our tagged lowest price guarantee items at a lower price, we'll give you double the difference with purchase.
Eat better, spend less, that's Wise.
If you're looking to make an impact, there's no better place to do that than the U.S. Army. Whether your goal is to fight and cure deadly diseases, develop technologies, or seek adventures across the globe, the Army is where all of that can happen, and so much more. The Army is a team of a million individuals working together to take on the most complex problems in the nation and the world, and to win. Ask yourself, what's your warrior? Go to army.com/Baltimore to find out. To learn more, contact your local Army recruiter and find us on social media at U.S. Army Baltimore.
All right. Ravens win 38-6 in week one over the Cleveland Browns. Casey, what were your big fantasy storylines from the early games today?
You know, a couple of things that were really kind of cool. Some things expected, some things not expected. By the way, Adrian Peterson, who showed up midweek in Detroit, led that backfield today with 14 carries so far for 93 yards. They're still playing right now. They're driving against the Bears. Josh Jacobs, I told everybody he would be a top eight fantasy running back this year, 3 touchdowns. That was very nice. Dalvin Cook, the newly paid.
It was a slow start
slow
for
start,
him today.
Slow start.
Thankfully, they were getting their asses kicked.
You know, Seattle, interesting.
Russell Wilson throwing the football. Novel concept
today. 35 throws for Russell Wilson, 31 of 35, 322, 4 touchdowns. Nobody had more than... than 7 carries.
Carson still had a huge day because he caught
Two touchdowns, and he caught 6 balls, which is nice. But he was out-touched rushing the ball by Carlos Hyde. Little concerning there. By the way, the downfall of Aaron Rodgers,
grossly exaggerated.
Exaggerated. He had a day, folks. 364, 4 touchdowns. Somebody asked me this morning, who is your deep sleeper of the day? I got one right.
Yeah, Aaron Rodgers.
No, I said Valdez Scantling.
Oh, okay.
4 for 96 with a touchdown. By the way, every receiver, Davante Adams, 2 touchdowns, even Alan Lazard, who I know a lot of people played, and Aaron Jones, huge day. On the sad side, Marlon Mack looks like he is done for the year with an Achilles. I know that there will be lots of Jonathan Taylor owners that – you know, will benefit from that. But Marlon Mack was a guy that if you took him in the mid rounds, he was the guy to start that. I mean, Jonathan Taylor didn't have a first quarter touch. Let's just put that out there. It was going to be a split.
He's
going to
be getting a lot more.
He had a nice day. And Cam Newton rushes for 2. Can't throw
a thing,
but rushes 2 in.
Unfortunately, Antonio Gibson, all the good things that went well for Washington, he didn't do much of anything.
Look, I tried to warn people. True. I really tried to. We didn't know.
Except you told me to play him in the league where I didn't have Miles Sanders. So,
well, who did I tell you to play him over?
I don't remember. If I remembered, I'd tell you. I don't remember.
But that's the thing. Gibson got touches, but he didn't get the goal line touches. That went to Peyton Barber. And I think the more disappointing thing, last I checked, he only had 2 catches in that game out of the backfield. So, you know, but It was a fun fantasy day.
We will be talking more fantasy football coming up Thursday at 11:30 a.m. KZ joins us for the Press Box Fantasy Football Show. Looking forward to that. And, of course, if you're seeing this mask that I've got around my... Oh, KZ's got one, too. Look at that. There it is. These masks, very cool, are available right now. PressBoxOnline.com/masks is how you can get them. Very nice. Voguing, KZ. They're available for you right now. We've got a couple different styles. These ones are the state flag with the purple and orange. I can't think of why, any reason at all, that might be the case. And you, in fact, get a four-pack of these particular masks for just $29.95. Other masks available include the Celebrate 8 MVP mask. Can only imagine why that might be the case.
Don't know.
Any guess at all? Is available as well. That's another gator-style mask. And then we have a over-the-ear state flag-style mask in sort of a distressed version of the flag. They're all available right now, PressBoxOnline.com/masks. Ravens win going away. Any final thoughts from you, KZ?
It was really good. I know there's lots of problems in the world. It was really good to have a distraction day and have NFL football
super
back.
Pleasant. It was super it was, pleasant.
I didn't even turn the game on till 1:03 because whatever everybody did, that's up to them, and whatever the NFL did is up to them.
I got to be honest with you. Felt like attention porn on the network's part. Now, I sort of understand that they have an obligation to cover those things, but it did feel. We know as a fact that the networks don't always put this much attention on those moments.
Correct.
And for example, they didn't show the Lift Every Voice and Sing performance, right? They didn't show that on the network that I know. I didn't flip over, frankly.
They did on Jay-Z.
Okay, they did. They all right. Yeah, fair enough.
They didn't show that. They didn't do the national anthem. They did.
Well, no, I saw the national anthem.
Oh, I didn't see
it. I saw that as the thing was starting. So it just felt like there was a little bit of we're hoping to get people riled up and to get people angry and
maybe so.
I don't know.
Maybe so. I purposely didn't turn the TV on because I just wanted to enjoy football. I thoroughly enjoyed football. The lack of fans in the stands, I'll be honest, didn't bother me at all.
No, you know what? It really didn't impact me.
It didn't impact me. It didn't. I didn't mind the noise that they pumped in because it was so light.
Yeah.
That it really
minimal impact.
It was just for me. It was maybe the first day in 6 months that really felt like a normal day.
Really nice that CBS included some coverage for Mogaba during the course of the broadcast.
Absolutely. That and was such a classy thing by the Ravens.
Yep, that was really wonderful. Better news, John Harbaugh says they do not believe that Ronnie Stanley has a serious injury.
I hope that is very, very true.
You hope that is the case, as that's all this is. John Harbaugh just said, don't believe Ronnie Stanley has sustained a serious injury, says he just got rolled up on. That would be wonderful news.
Wonderful news.
Coming out of a day like this.
They're really two positions that can't afford to lose that person, and he's one of them.
There's no doubt. No doubt. They are a much different football team if they don't have Ronnie Stanley, but the good news is it appears as though he is all right. And they chug along next week, late Sunday afternoon game, a 4 o'clock game as the Ravens take on the Texans. I think it's actually a 4:25 game.
Yeah.
As the Ravens take on the Texans. KZ will be back with me for Project Game Day next Sunday. Looking forward to that.
By the way, Joe Burrow has started his NFL career 5 for 6 for 26 yards.
I like Joe Burrow.
I like him a lot. I think he's going to be a good player.
It could be a problem in this division for some time. He's not as – the Bengals are by no means as offensive as the Browns and the Steelers are, but, he could prove to be a problem for some time, issue.
I look forward to him being a little bit of a problem. I like when good players play against good players. Ben's not going
to
be here for much longer.
Correct. Baker may not be a big, right.
You know, so
boy, look, number of commercials that you still you're like, dude, you guys couldn't think of anything else.
I know.
This offseason to pivot to. And the funny thing is, the rain commercial. It's a great concept.
Oh.
It's just hilarious that you're still doing it with Baker Mayfield.
Absolutely.
It's the concept works. You just maybe introduce any. any other relevant quarterback into it.
I liked his commercials last year, the ones with this in the stadium.
Oh, yeah.
They were terrific.
They were all good. Unfortunately,
he's not the guy.
You're laughing about it because it's Baker Mayfield. You're like, come on, what are we doing here? All right, Ravens 1-0 to start the season. They win 38-6. I'll be with you tomorrow morning, 10 to noon, for Glenn Clark Radio to talk more about it. KZ will be back next Sunday. Thanks to Wise Markets and to the U.S. Army for making it possible. Thanks to all of you for joining in. This has been the Project Game Day Post Game Show. We will see you next Sunday.